Big news out of collegiate sports, a lawsuit from former and current student athletes at historically black institutions looks to hold to account the NCAA for what they call systemic and longstanding division and separation in monitoring academic progress among the black colleges and other member institutions. Here to talk with us today, a friend of the show, Dr. Monique Ositelu, the founder and chief data consultant at Data Driven Consulting and Solutions, who talks about some of the numbers and the perspectives behind APR academic progress rate in the NCAA and the disparate impacts it's had on black athletes over a number of years. So Dr. Ositelu, is again, it's an honor to have you on today.
Thank you for having me on again. So I appreciate it. Thank you.
So first, let's give some folks some of your background. How long have you been studying academic progress rate in the NCAA as it pertains to race and to some of the small institutions and particularly the historically black colleges?
Definitely. About 5 years. So it's going on 6 years. So ever since I started my doctoral program, I'm actually a former Division I track and field athlete. And so just from my experience, I've been interested and just evaluating NCAA and how it works. And so I've been doing this research about for 5 or 6 years, and it continued to stem from my dissertation, which I continue to do after I completed my doctoral program.
You have discovered that there are significant differences in the ways that HBCUs receive sanctions and academic progress rate. But I think that before we get into that conversation, can you, just for listeners who are unfamiliar with what APR is, can you kind of break down, I guess, the formulaic approach that the NCAA has said, here's what it takes for an institution to be compliant and eligible based on the academic performance of its graduates?
Definitely. So in theory, the APR, academic progress rate, is under the umbrella of the academic performance program, which was a means to be able to track academic progress to go towards graduation. So the NCAA tracks two indicators. They look at retention, that means being able to retain the same student athlete at the same institution year after year. And then they look at academic eligibility. Are you making progressive progress towards your degree? Mm-hmm. Based on those two metrics, the NCAA has created a calculation, a point system, where they give teams a point. And so if you meet a certain standard, then it determines if you receive a penalty or not. And so now the current standard is 930. Which they have equated to be equal to about a 50% graduation rate. Mm-hmm. And so in theory, the whole concept is if you're graduating about 50% of your athletes on your team, good job. If you're not, then your athletes deserve to be penalized. And it's in hopes that decreasing your competition season, not letting you do postseason bans, you will redirect your efforts to focus on your academics and improve your graduation rates. But note that this metric is based on the previous 4 years. It's not mm-hmm. actually real time.
What is it that has created some of the disparities for HBCUs in the way that APR is considered? I know that they're multi-layered and they don't target HBCUs, but some of the resource issues with HBCUs and some of the nuances of when athletes come into a program, when they leave, when they graduate, in comparison to when African-American students typically come into a collegiate experience and when they graduate, mm-hmm. there are correlations between why there's this constant idea that HBCUs underperform on academic progress. Can you talk about some of those disparities?
Yeah, so like you said, there are a lot of layers to it. So when you look at it overall on a high level, it really comes down to resources and mission, right? Mm-hmm. And so as we understand the historical underpinnings of funding at black colleges, how they were originally referred to, and then they became HBCUs, we know that they are significantly underfunded. And the institutional wealth gap, just even in Division I, is very large, right? Mm-hmm. And so they've already determined that there are about all Division I HBCU schools are in the bottom 15% of athletic budgets for Division I. And so they're all designated as limited resource institutions, right? And so that includes all of our Division I HBCUs. And so it's a huge difference in resources on an institutional wealth level. And then when you break it down a little bit further, there is also a resource issue looking at athletic departments and their budgets. And so that's a huge thing. And so when there are resource issues, there are resource issues and be able to support the academic progress of your student athlete. So what does that look like? Advisors, ratio of student to athlete, advising them on what type of classes they should take to be able to juggle their athletic commitments, you know, with their course load, things of that nature, tutoring. And so there's so many things that trickles down to the student level based on resources. And then secondly, it's the mission, right? We know the mission of HBCUs. It came from segregation as a means for us to provide us education, us meaning Black people. That's how I identify myself. Education to better ourselves and get opportunity to higher learning, right? And so it has continued to be of even more use now. It's very, very useful now because it provides what people say a second chance. So giving opportunities for students who are academically at risk. HBCUs do a great job at educating first-generation college students, low-income students, and so things of that nature. So their whole student body, their mission, even their practices are very different from non-HBCUs or predominantly white institutions, which makes it very different to reach this uniform standard.
What are some of the most stunning statistics from APR sanctions between HBCUs and PWIs that you have seen over the last several years that really make you think like, wow, this is really not fair. This is really, there's no way the HBCUs can keep up with this. What are some of the, I guess, the anecdotes that you have viewed and said, this best illustrates how far this gap is between one set of schools and another?
Yeah, so I think, I'll get to the statistics part, but it's something that I read literally the first 2 weeks of me doing this research. And I said, this is my research area. Right. I was reading an article that was written by a researcher at NCAA, part of their research team. And they basically stated that the NCAA was aware from the very beginning, when they were even creating this metric, that HBCUs would have a challenge in meeting this metric. However, when they implemented in 2003, they didn't provide any supports to be able to mitigate that discrepancy in being able to reach this metric. And so from the start, they were already at a disadvantage and the NCAA didn't do anything to assist them and provide supports to help. But then when I began to really look at the data from the beginning, 2003, almost two decades later, HBCUs have been disproportionately penalized. So there are times when there are years, I can't remember the specific years and I apologize, but during the past 10 years, there have been years, about 75% of the sports teams that have been sanctioned are HBCUs. And it's ridiculous because HBCU athletics, they make about 6% of all sports teams, but right. They are proportionally represented as receiving these penalties. I think for me, another thing I saw in my research is I evaluated the very early years, so 2005 to 2010. And during that time, they had like a two-tiered system where at that time, the standard was 900 for the absolutely lowest benchmark. And so if you reached 900, you really got more severe penalties. Well, below 900 overwhelmingly was more non-HBCUs below the 900 standard. But during that time, HBCUs were about three times as likely to receive a penalty when non-HBCUs with similar low APR scores received nothing. So it's not an issue.
How is that possible?
You know, very good question. I emailed NCAA, asked, you know, what's going on? Why aren't they uniformly receiving treatments? And they just let me know what you see in the data is correct. So I can't answer that question for you. And that's what it really gets to me as far as this inequity and this issue about race really coming down to it is because even when you have comparable scores, they're still being disproportionately penalized compared to their PWI counterparts.
What has been some of the data reflective of the ways that I guess the NCAA has worked to address some of those issues? Because they've created funding programs for schools that have been on APR sanction. You know, we'll give you a grant. You can hire a compliance person. You can get more technology in your department. Has that changed the trend marks of punishment and sanction over the years, or have you maintained, or what has been the trend now?
That's a good point. So the trend has kind of been the same, but I did do an evaluation where I did try to see if receiving the funding had a positive impact on APR scores. Mm-hmm. And actually, the impact really were with the male teams, the men's teams, which you see disproportionately more men's teams receiving penalties. So it makes sense. The teams that are having the most issue, you'll actually see the biggest jump. Mm-hmm. So it was effective in helping them reach APR. Was it effective in graduation rates, which is their ultimate goal? That's the question that's still waiting. And I think for me, the issue that I have with these grants is this whole concept of theory. Everything sounds great in theory, like they're helping. But they literally waited until 2013, 10 years after, you know, these APR penalties have already wreaked havoc, and they knew from the beginning that they would. And so, but still, even receiving these grants is still not enough to mitigate that institutional wealth between non-HBCUs and HBCU sports programs.
Let's talk about the idea, and I think this is more to your life as a student athlete. What does it mean from an athletic perspective if you see a team on sanction? You know, you can't compete in postseason play. In your case, this would be, you know, track and field nationals, you know, certain invitationals, you know, to not have the same level of practice time. That plays a major role in you're being able to compete with the best in the country. From a marketing perspective or a recruitment standpoint, how do those sanctions really embed into families' decision and athletes' decision to choose one school over another one?
Definitely. So let's say I'm a freshman coming in. If they did not meet the APR metric the previous 4 years and I'm coming in, I'm automatically going to be penalized as well, even though this is my first time stepping on campus and sitting down in a classroom. And so what ends up happening is this whole theory that I've been developing is about the dismantling of HBCU athletic programs through the use of institutional policies, right? And so it's this idea that if I want to go to an HBCU, this is the institution I want to go to, but they have a penalty, I am then going to look at other options. And what you begin to see is literally this hydraulic displacement of Black athletic talent leaving HBCUs and going to non-HBCUs, not because that's their original intent, but because of these barriers that have been implemented by academic policies that NCAA has had a constant pattern of using them to disadvantage not only Black institutions, but Black student athletes. And I can say, because I was a former track and field athlete, if I was in that position, I'd be lucky because it's an individual sport. Mm-hmm. So they have some waivers to allow track athletes, if you were okay, you weren't the one to cause it, to be able to compete. But if you're in a sport like a team sport, like football, basketball, then if your team doesn't make it, regardless of how well you did, you miss out on that opportunity for March Madness to be seen, that visibility of allowing us to be on that platform.
Do you feel like HBCUs are at a disadvantage, not in the way of competing in the era of APR, but our ability resource-wise to game the system? For example, you hear all the time about football teams, basketball teams, men's and women's basketball, a certain set of scholarships can go to a certain amount of students who will perform well and rise the tide of the overall graduation rate of the team. It's not cheating, but it's gaming the system. Mm-hmm. That's something that you think smaller schools, HBCUs, just can't take advantage of because scholarship, you know, allowances are what they are. Or here's the mission of the school. What do you think prohibits the school from diving into those loopholes like other institutions do?
Yeah, definitely. So like you said, there's a lot of layers. When you begin to peel back the onion, you really realize that APR actually is based only on student athletes who are receiving scholarships. So it's not based on the entire team, only those who are receiving student athlete scholarships. And so, like you said, if you're at an institution that has a great endowment, awesome booster club, they can create these scholarships so that you can still be funded. You know, I know that I have an athlete that is not going to be a high academic achieving athlete, but they're amazing on the field, on the court. We need them for this actual enterprise of athletics. And so what they'll do is they will create these alternative institutional scholarships, and that student has a full ride and they still get to participate and everything like that. HBCUs don't have that latitude and flexibility to really game the system in that way. And then on top of that, programs that have more resources, they actually have people that's their job is to figure out how we're going to meet the APR metric. And let's intervene, because if I see something's off, I can actually say, go to the coach and say, hey, you got a few athletes that are going to cause you all to miss this APR score. You need to make some adjustments. Again, that staffing, that support, that more comprehensive athletic academic programs have, that is not comparable at all HBCUs within Division I.
You've been doing this work for years. You've done a whole bunch of interviews about your research and analysis of these numbers. I got to tell you, it's not your question to answer, but I will ask it. Do you ever wonder and look at, like, you know, why the hell do HBCUs stick with it? And what alternatives could be? Obviously, if you're going to stay with it, the answer is more money. Mm-hmm. In light of that, then you ask the question, or have you ever found yourself asking the question, why do you keep running into this wall?
Yeah, I ask myself that question. I also ask myself, are there efforts to actually challenge this metric from HBCU leadership? Just because I do research, quantitative research, so I don't always get the people-to-people interaction. So I do have those questions, and I do ask myself why, if you know that it is disadvantaging your students and having an adverse effect on your athletic programs. I don't know why, but it is something that definitely does keep me up at night wondering, you know, I see it, I'm showing the data, I'm showing these issues, and why after two decades there hasn't been any change?
It's a fascinating question, and we are grateful that you are a thought leader and a numbers cruncher on these efforts. Plug your company so we can get you on campus talking about some of these issues and consulting some of our HBCUs on APR issues and possible solutions.
Yeah, definitely. So I'm founder and chief data consultant of my data consulting firm, Data Driven Consulting and Solutions, where I do just this. I provide data analytics to be able to help collegiate athletic departments improve academic outcomes, and the list goes on. And you can reach me at ddcns.com. You can also find me on my Twitter handle at Monique Ositelu, or also on LinkedIn, my name, Monique Ositelu.